Matthew Wilson is a distinguished software engineer at Instil Software, and he's also an AWS community builder focusing on serverless. So without taking much time, let's give a big round of applause to Matthew Wilson.
Thank you. Cheers. In the 1970s and 80s, this phrase, "nobody ever got fired for buying IBM," was a popular way of describing IT executives who continued to buy from IBM even though there was potentially better or cheaper alternatives available. And the reason being is that it was the perceived safe choice. And I think we can draw a similar parallel between that attitude that was back then to what we see today towards serverless, where serverless for many people is perceived as an unsafe choice. And that's despite the benefits of serverless being really clear and proven. It automatically provisions and scales, it's highly available and secure, and you only pay for what you use. And I think the main reason for that lack of adoption comes down to fear. Fear of the cost, fear of the scaling, fear of the developer experience. And whenever I started my first serverless project, the thing that I was fearful of the most was choosing the correct database. Whenever you're working with serverless and AWS, the standout choice is DynamoDB. But with DynamoDB, there's this notion that you need to know all of your access patterns up front. And that's something that was fearful for me, because how can I possibly know all of my access patterns up front in a world of ever-changing requirements? And I decided to see if that fear was something that just I had experienced, or had other people experienced the same as well. So I asked a group of community builders a question. When you first started your serverless journey, what were you afraid of, and how did you overcome it? And I got some really, really good answers. The first person said that they were fearful that getting up to speed with the serverless paradigm was going to take a long time, and it would be ages before they'd actually see any benefits. But in actual fact, what happens was they shipped their first Lambda function to production in just a few days. That really motivated the team. They started to have lots of success with serverless, and that increased their adoption over time. The next person said at an organizational level, they were fearful that it wasn't going to add any value to their systems or to their customers, and that they were worried about education, you know, not just around serverless, but distributed systems in general. And really the answer to that problem was they needed to educate themselves on the value that it would bring to their organization. The next one was a person who was really an early adopter of serverless, and they were actually fearful that it wouldn't gain any market share, that they'd be left with an architecture that they couldn't hire any developers to work on. But in actual fact, in my experience, as soon as we get engineers working on a serverless project, they don't want to work on anything else. This one deserves a very special mention. After a super painful move off of Engine Yard and later OpsWorks, we were pretty anxious about packaging business logic as a zip file. And I don't know about you, but whenever I first read that, I heard the pain in those engineers' voice. And really, what we should do is just have a brief moment of silent reflection for what they had to endure. But circling back to my own fear, the fear of knowing all of your access patterns up front, for me, all I needed to do was educate myself. Educate myself on how DynamoDB works. To do that, I used the DynamoDB book by Alex DeBrie. I can't recommend it highly enough. And along with a team of developers, we shipped a serverless car insurance platform that we built from scratch in just 12 months. In this talk, we're going to look at how you can overcome your fears and go from zero to serverless. And we're going to look at four things: how you can encourage a serverless mindset, how you can enlighten developers that writing less code is better, how you can enable production deployments with confidence, and how you can equip teams to deliver business value. But before we get into that, let me just introduce myself. My name is Matthew Wilson. I'm husband to Rebecca, father to Joy Tabitha, a distinguished engineer at Instil, and an AWS community builder. This project that we're going to talk about today is probably one of the best projects I've ever worked on. Part of that is the serverless nature, but so much more is my awesome colleagues at Instil. So when I'm given a talk like this, I always just take a chance to just thank them for all of their hard work. The product that we're going to talk about is called Stroll. Stroll is a car insurance website in Northern Ireland. Unfortunately, if you don't live in Northern Ireland, you can't take out a policy with them. But if you go to strollinsurance.co.uk right now, type in your car registration, and complete that whole journey, buy a policy, log into your account, the entire journey is fully serverless. And in my opinion, that makes car insurance 10 times cooler. And the vision for Stroll was this: a digitally led brokering business combining innovative technology with industry-leading expertise to deliver exceptional customer experiences. But we don't really care about that this afternoon. What we care about is it's a shiny new platform built with managed services on AWS. And from the offset, we as a team decided that we were going to build this using serverless technologies. One of the best things about our careers is that we can take an empty Git repository and turn that into a business for somebody. And that feeling, I don't think, ever gets old as an engineer. But what we learned through the duration of this project is that if you leverage serverless technologies, you can do that in a much more mature and a much better way. And what you need to start off with doing is encouraging a serverless mindset. And if you've never really worked with serverless before, and you're not really drinking the serverless Kool-Aid, as my colleague would say, you might not know there's a serverless mindset at all. Its origins lie in a blog post written by Ben Kehoe entitled Serverless is a State of Mind. And if you've never read it, I would recommend you go and do that. It's absolutely brilliant. And inside that article, what the author lays out is the fact that serverless isn't about the underlying technology. It's not about Lambda functions. It's not about DynamoDB. It's not about S3. What it's actually about is what you focus on. Instead of focusing on the technology, you should focus on delivering business value to your customers instead. And if you want to adopt this serverless mindset, I don't think it's something that you can do from just an individual level. It has to happen at an organizational level. And at Instil, we had an engineering strategy, and in it we had this line. We want to embrace serverless, but this requires a cultural change in how we approach building software. And there is going to be a cultural change, because if you look at serverless objectively and you start to ask some questions, is it easier to deploy? Well, the answer is not really. It's the same as anything else. Infrastructure as code frameworks has really solved that problem for us. Is it easier to test? Not at all. It's very, very different to how you would test, let's say, a Spring Boot application. You have to change your testing strategy. And is it easier to actually write the code for? Only if you educate yourself first. So we had engineers who were asking themselves this question, all these different questions, and were sort of saying to themselves, maybe we've made a mistake here. Maybe this is just too much work. This is different to what we're used to. Maybe we should just roll back and just deploy a container with Spring Boot on it like we have in the past. And what we had to do was enlighten our engineers that writing less code is actually better. And like I said, people had their doubts, and they had to change the mindset and look at the bigger picture. It wasn't just about what they were trying to, or what, you know, what it meant to them as an engineer. We had to look at things from how does it mean for Instil as a services company, and also what it means to our actual customers as well. And what we should really do is write the code that really matters. I'm not here on this stage saying don't write any code at all, because if that's what the future looks like, I'm just going to quit my job. I love writing code. I just want to write the code that actually makes a difference to my customers, rather than just writing code for writing code's sake. And I remember whenever I first started to learn to write code, there's a moment, and hopefully if you're an engineer, you've had the same experience, where it sort of just clicks in your mind, and you're like, right, okay, I'm going to go change the world with all my new skills. And I had the same experience with serverless. And to explain that, I need to tell you a story. There I was working from home during a global pandemic. I was working on what you can see here. This is the customer portal for Stroll. And the ticket was really simple. I had to fetch some data from DynamoDB, return that to the client, and then display it to the user. But little did I know that my life was about to change forever. This is what our architecture looked like. We were using AWS AppSync. It's the managed GraphQL server. It was using Lambda data sources, which were then going and querying DynamoDB tables to get the policy information that they needed. But to cut a long story short, for the customer portal in Stroll, we were able to use the direct service integrations between AppSync and DynamoDB to be able to deliver all the functionality we needed without writing any real code at all. Instead of writing code, we were instead pushing all of that into configuration instead, and we were using the CDK to do that. And really, what notion sort of came to our head is that we were no longer just writing code. We were actually playing with AWS Lego, and we were trying to just connect these different building blocks together to actually deliver a solution to our customers. And as a side note, if you're familiar with the CDK, because it uses a type-safe language, I think it really reinforces this metaphor around, you know, building blocks. And if two services are really easy to connect together, then the CDK will make that, you know, really simple. But if you start to feel some resistance, you know, like your blocks aren't quite connecting together, then I think that's a really red flag that perhaps you're not integrating those two services together correctly. Perhaps you need to put something in the middle to solve that problem instead. And you know, if you really want to encourage your teams to embrace this serverless mindset and learn that writing less code is better, you need to have some key people to drive that forward. You need to have some engineers who are going to learn about how to do things properly, learn about the benefits of these things. And a colleague of mine has this really great quote where being a software engineer is really just agreeing to do homework for the rest of your life. As soon as you stop doing your homework, you're going to become a lot less useful as an engineer. And you know, I was the same. I had my doubts. You know, there was people who were saying to me, you know, have we made a mistake? And what we needed to do was educate ourselves on how to do this properly. You know, we're always told that code is a liability. And we understand what we're saying in that phrase, but let's be honest with ourselves. Do you actually think in your head, you know, it's their code that's a liability? My code's perfect, but all of your code is just utter garbage, you know? And we need to set those notions to one side. It's not about, you know, my code being better than yours. It's about writing the code that really matters. And we had to educate our, or enable our engineers to be able to take ownership of the problems that they were trying to solve. And we believe that if they were able to take ownership, they would start to adopt this serverless mindset. I need to make a huge disclaimer to reInvent this afternoon. I'm a huge Apple fanboy, and my secret dream job is to be an iOS developer just living off my App Store profits. And if you're familiar with iOS development, you'll know that Swift is now the primary language, and Swift is an open source language, and there's this process called Swift Evolution, and it's how you can propose like new language features. And I decided to take this idea and put it to use in our own team, and we created what we called the Stroll Evolution. And the Stroll Evolution process looks something like this. It includes a proposed solution to achieve a goal, information about the design, what the effects are going to be on our clients, as well as any alternatives considered. It's always good whenever you can answer, but why didn't you do it some other way, at least even for yourself in the future? So I've got this thing that's like an RFC and an architectural decision record all rolled into one thing. And it's a really just simple Confluence template with a few headings. And through this Stroll Evolution process, there's a few key aspects of our project that we solved. The first one was, it was how we figured out how to correctly model our first DynamoDB table. And like I said, we used Alex DeBree's book to do that. We also used it to plan out our first step function, and not only what the step function was actually trying to do, but why we would even use step functions in the first place. And it's also how we determined how we were going to process insurance policy documents, which are a really critical part of how our application works. And what we were trying to do here was really just give our engineers some kind of ownership over the things they were trying to solve. And what we believe is that if you let engineers take ownership of these problems, propose how to solve it, and just let them solve that problem, then they will really have to come to make the decisions themselves. Do I want to spend 2 weeks building something from scratch? Or do I want to spend, you know, 2 hours, 2 days connecting some existing managed services together and just get on with trying to solve the hard problems? And for us, really what we were trying to focus on in Stroll was just an excellent customer experience. Really what happens in the back end was less important to us than what happened in the front end. We could focus more on really working on that UI and UX instead. I'm not saying that this Stroll Evolution process is going to solve all of your problems. And what I'm trying to talk about here is giving your engineers some kind of ownership over the things that they're trying to solve. But once we gave them ownership, we also wanted to enable them to actually get those changes into production with confidence. And we wanted everybody in the team to have the confidence to kick off a production deployment. But we'd actually reached a rut in our project, maybe six months in, maybe a year in, where I was the one who was doing all of the deployments. And I really didn't want that responsibility. It wasn't me saying, I'm doing it. It was something that naturally happened because people had fear of breaking something. And that fear came because of how we were actually testing that our application was functioning correctly. Hopefully you're familiar with what's on the screen here. Everybody calls it the testing pyramid. I call it the testing triangle. But you know, the notion is that you can have, there's many different testing shapes. This one here highlights that you have lots of unit tests. They're cheap to write and cheap to maintain. You have, you know, a little less integration tests and then even less end-to-end tests. But overall, you get really good test coverage in many different areas. But our testing triangle looked like this. we had an abundance of unit tests, way too many unit tests, that weren't providing any value at all, and really they were just there for unit testing sake. We didn't have any hard limits on code coverage, but there just was lots of unit tests there. And we had some end-to-end tests, which were incredibly valuable. But like I said, we were starting to use more and more direct integrations, more and more managed services. Unit tests started to become less and less valuable. And the reason why we were missing that key integration test layer is because serverless integration testing is really hard. You know, you've got two choices. You can deploy to AWS and test it there, or you can try and simulate AWS in your developer environment. In my opinion, the best way of doing this is on AWS. And what we did was we used the stroll evolution process to put together a plan. And what we came to the decision was that an integration test in this project is defined as one that tests integrations with AWS services. When we make calls to third-party services, we mock those out instead. And what we started to see was that this gave our team much more confidence in doing deployments. I'm not even on the project anymore, so it's not my responsibility, it's other people. And our deployment frequency has increased because of those integration testing changes that we made. And we started small, and we built up our test coverage over time. And just as we wrap this up, we're just going to see how this can all come together to equip your teams to deliver business value. And there's a little case study that we're going to look at, and that is the ability to request a physical copy of your car insurance documents. In the United Kingdom, it's actually a requirement that you can be a digital-only insurance company, but you have to give your customers a way of getting a physical copy of their documents. And this was costing our customer hundreds of thousands of pounds a year, believe it or not. And with two really junior engineers, one was a graduate with just less than a year of experience. The other person was an apprentice who was just out of high school. They were able to leverage AWS Step Functions to solve this problem. And like I said, in a much more scalable and a much more safer and mature way. This step function that they created does a lot of things for them that, you know, they might not have been able to do if we were just letting them work with something that wasn't managed for them. It orchestrates the flow of events. Like you see, it takes those events, passes them through those various Lambda functions, and controls how that event's going to flow through this workload. And the other one that's incredibly valuable for us is that it visualizes a state. And that's something that would have been incredibly hard for two junior engineers to actually build. Instead, they're able to leverage the managed service. We can go look at any request for any given customer. We can see the ones that have succeeded. We can see the ones that have failed. We can click through into that and then see exactly what part has failed. And now with new features announced in the last couple of weeks, you can retry from where that step function has actually left off. And the key takeaway here is that we should be using the tools at our disposal to move faster and focus on delivering value to your customer. So we've looked at how you can encourage a serverless mindset, how you can enlighten developers that writing less code is better, how you can enable production deployments with confidence, and then equip teams to deliver business value. But I wouldn't be any kind of engineer if I just left it there. So I anonymously surveyed our team, and I asked them a few questions. When you first started on this project, how much did you fear serverless? And you can see that because we had a mixed bag of experience within our team, we got a mixed bag of responses. 5 is you feared it a lot. 0 is you didn't really fear it at all. And you can see that's a mixed response. But then I asked them, how much do you enjoy working with serverless and stroll? And you can see that we got a really positive response here. Our engineers love working on serverless. And like I said, if you try to take them off that serverless project, they really dig their heels in. This is my favorite slide, this one here. How much do you think that serverless has helped your career? Like I said, we have people who are at the very beginning of their career, and they very positively responded, saying that they think that it has helped their career. So they're not feeling that they're working with some kind of legacy services. They're working with the future. And that was a really positive thing to see as a leader of that team. And then I asked them, how likely would you be to opt for a serverless architecture again? And again, a really positive response. And then just one absolute traitor who gave me a 3. And I don't know who it is, but someday I will find them, and I'll hunt them down. So thank you very much. If you have any questions for me or anything, you can chat to me out in the expo here. I'll hang around for a little bit, and yeah, thank you.